space infections, though rare than in the past, it is on a rise, especially in post-COVID patients. We need more clinical trials to confirm this observation, even though the deep neck space infections are important clinically. And one of the deep neck space infection is a parapharyngeal abscess. So in this class, I will explain what is parapharyngeal space, that is anatomy of parapharyngeal space, and also clinical significance of this parapharyngeal space, and then the approaches to parapharyngeal tumors. Okay, so parapharyngeal space. Okay. Parapharyngeal space. So it is para to pharynx. You know what is pharynx. So this is parallel to pharynx. Okay. So it is something parallel to the pharynx. There are two parallel sides. Laterally, there are two parapharyngeal space. Okay. So there are so many synonyms for this parapharyngeal space. They are, as I already told you, one is lateral pharyngeal space. Okay. So, lateral pharyngeal space. Okay. Then, it is pharyngomaxillary space. Okay. So, it is pharyngomaxillary. Or, I'll draw that diagram first. Then, it will be easy for you to remember the synonyms. Okay. So, it is actually an inverted pyramid which is related to the skull base and to the greater horn of hyoid bone. Okay, this is greater horn of hyoid bone. This parapharyngeal space is an inverted pyramid. With the superiorly comes the skull base. Here, skull, this is mandible, angle of mandible, and skull base. And inferiorly, it is apex is at a, related to the greater horn of hyoid bone. Okay, so it is an inverted pyramid. So the pyramid has got a base and apex. And four sides also. See, it is here. So this parapharyngeal space comes exactly between the skull base and apex towards the greater horn of hyoid bone. Okay. So from this you can easily remember the synonyms. Okay. The lateral pharyngeal space, lateral, or it can be a pharyngomaxillary. It is again related to the maxilla. So can be a pharyngomaxillary space, or we can call it as pterygomaxillary. Okay, pterygomaxillary space. Or it is also called a pterygopharyngeal space. All are same. Pterygopharyngeal. Peripharyngeal is yet another name for this. Okay, so now you know it is an inverted pyramid with the base towards the skull base and apex towards the greater horn of hyoid bone. While discussing on periodontal space and Kunci, I explained that this parapharyngeal space is lateral to the superior constrictor muscle or the pharyngobasilar fascia. So actually, medial relations will be this superior constrictor. So hope this picture is clear to you. Okay, this much. It's an inverted pyramid with a base towards the skull base and apex directed towards the greater horn of hyoid bone. Okay, now I'll draw the coronal section. So base is towards the skull base and apex is pointing towards the greater horn of hyoid bone. And this one is a coronal section. It was already explained along with the Kunci or periodontal abscess. So please go and refer that. And in this, so here comes the parapharyngeal space, this area, and from oropharynx, from medial to lateral. So the medial most, on opening the mouth, you can see tonsils on both sides. Here it is, uvula, and the opposite side. Okay. So tonsil, then it is a superior constrictor muscle, then the middle layer of deep cervical fascia. So what is the medial relation of this parapharyngeal space? This is parapharyngeal space. So medial relation is the middle layer of deep cervical fascia, which forms the buccopharyngeal membrane. This one, buccopharyngeal membrane, which overlies the superior constrictor muscle. Okay, so medially you have the buccopharyngeal membrane, which overlies the superior constrictor muscle, right? That is why this one, peritonsillar space, infections in this peritonsillar space can go into the parapharyngeal space, which is a complication. Okay, and here it is lateral relation. What forms laterally? This one, mandible, medial pterygoid, and parotid. So it is a superficial layer of deep fascia which is covering this mandible, medial pterygoid, and the parotid gland. So that forms the lateral boundary. Okay, so one more thing is there in lateral, that is from the skull base, this styloid process is coming. Styloid process. Styloid process is coming into this parapharyngeal space, and actually parapharyngeal space is divided into a pre-styloid compartment and a post or styloid compartment by the styloid process. Styloid process is not alone. It has got 5 attachments. So the styloid process along with these 5 attachments is called what? It is called the Ryland's bouquet, usually asked in bio. Ryland's bouquet. Okay, this one you have to remember. This it is Ryland's bouquet. This Ryland's bouquet has got white flowers and it has got red flowers also. Red flowers, you can think that it is muscles forms red muscle. I have already drawn it in red color. So muscles forms the red flowers and the ligament forms the white flowers. There are 3 red flowers and 2 white flowers in this Ryland's bouquet. So from the styloid process, what are the 2 white flowers or the ligaments? One is, here it is mandible. So stylomandibular ligament. Stylomandibular ligament. And which is another bone? Here it is hyoid bone, isn't it? So stylohyoid ligament. These 2 are the ligaments. Okay, stylohyoid and stylomandibular ligaments forms the white flowers of Ryland's bouquet. And there are 3 red flowers which are the muscles. Which are they? One is styloglossus. Tongue comes here. This is oropharynx, and in the oral cavity there is tongue. So styloglossus. Then the pharyngeal mucosa, stylopharyngeus, and stylohyoid. Okay. So these 3 muscles forms the 3 red flowers, and this 2 ligament forms the white flowers. Together they are known as the Ryland's bouquet. Okay, that you have to remember. I told because it comes along with this. And this stylomandibular ligament actually forms a tunnel. So in the this projecting into the styloid, from the styloid process, a stylomandibular ligament is projecting, and through this ligament the deep lobe of parotid gland is projecting into the parapharyngeal space. That is why if you have tumors of the deep lobe of parotid gland, it is actually presenting or pushing the pharynx medially. Okay, so that is the lateral boundary. So medially, it is a middle layer of deep cervical fascia, which is forms the pharyngobasilar fascia. It forms the buccopharyngeal fascia, buccopharyngeal membrane, overlying the superior constrictor muscle. And laterally, it is a superficial layer of deep fascia, deep cervical fascia, which covers the mandible, medial pterygoid muscle, and the parotid gland. again anterior relation and posterior relation. So anteriorly, this one anteriorly, what comes here? This is mandible and also this medial pterygoid muscle. Okay, so it is anteriorly, it is the superficial layer of deep cervical fascia which overlies this medial pterygoid muscle, forming a pterygomandibular raphe. So anteriorly relation is pterygomandibular raphe. Okay, that is superficial layer of deep cervical fascia which covers this medial pterygoid muscle anteriorly. Okay, and posteriorly, here you can see that postero laterally it is the carotid sheath along with the internal jugular vein, carotid artery, and the cranial nerve. Which are cranial nerve? Cranial nerves 9, 10 and 12. It is a glossopharyngeal, vagus and hypoglossal nerve. Though accessory nerve is also there, but it is protected by the sternocleidomastoid. So for all practical purpose, we can tell it as the internal jugular vein, internal carotid artery and 9, 10 and 12 cranial nerves. It forms posterolateral relation, and posteromedially it is a retropharyngeal space. Okay. So these are the relations. I'll repeat. It is an inverted pyramid shaped with the base towards the skull base and apex towards the greater horn of hyoid bone. It is actually between the muscles of mastication and muscles of deglutition. A space between muscles of mastication and muscles of deglutition. And medially it is by the middle layer of deep cervical fascia, which forms the buccopharyngeal membrane overlying the superior constrictor muscle, and laterally it is the superficial layer of deep cervical fascia which overlies mandible, medial pterygoid muscle and parotid gland. Anteriorly it is the pterygomandibular raphe, again it is the superficial layer of deep cervical fascia, and posteriorly, posterolaterally, the carotid sheath, and posteromedially it is communicating with the retropharyngeal space. Okay, I already told you that this styloid process is connecting with the mandible through this parapharyngeal space. Styloid process with the stylomandibular ligament is coming through this parapharyngeal space, and it is dividing this parapharyngeal space into a pre-styloid compartment and a post-styloid compartment. Pre-styloid and a post-styloid compartment. Pre-styloid, that is anterior to the stylomandibular ligament, and also a post-styloid compartment. So main vascular structures are in the post-styloid compartment. So what are things are there in the pre-styloid compartment? Then you can tell from this. Mainly there is adipose tissue or fat is there in this. Okay, the important structures are, one is fat or adipose tissue. Then what? There is deep lobe of parotid gland. Okay, parotid deep lobe. Which all nerves? There are three nerves in the pre-styloid compartment. One is an auriculotemporal nerve. Auriculotemporal, then lingual nerve, and also inferior alveolar nerve. At least remember, there's some nerves. Okay, so nerves, don't get panicked by all these. Don't think you can't remember. Just remember there are nerves also. So mainly fat is there, deep lobe of parotid is there, auriculotemporal, lingual and inferior alveolar nerve is there, and one vessel is also there, that is the internal maxillary artery. Okay, maxillary artery. So these are, and also along with the deep lobe of parotid gland, there are also some minor salivary glands and also ectopic salivary glands are also present in this pre-styloid compartment. Okay, and in the post-styloid compartment, there is this carotid sheath along with the cranial nerve 9, 10 and 12, and also there is sympathetic chain and also lymphatics. Okay, right? So carotid sheath, then sympathetic chain and also lymphatics. Okay. Carotid sheath, lymphatics, and carotid sheath, I already mentioned you, they contains 9, 10 and 12 nerves also, okay, right? And also sympathetic chain. Right? So, now you know the boundaries and you also know that this parapharyngeal space is divided into two spaces, a pre-styloid and a post-styloid compartment by the stylo-mandibular ligament. And you know the contents of each space also. Okay. Now, this space has got some relation with other spaces. That is very important if you want to know the spread of infection. So, what are the relations of this space? And regarding relations, it is again very evident from the diagram. Posteriorly, see posterior relation. Posteriorly, it can go to the retropharyngeal space. And also, it can go and spread it through the carotid sheath. And the carotid sheath is, you know that, it is a channel which goes to the superior mediastinum. Okay. So, actually it is called Lingen's highway, this carotid sheath. Once the infection has spread into the carotid sheath, it goes very easily, valvular space, it goes very easily to the superior mediastinum also. Otherwise called Lingen's highway, or again asked in vivas. Okay. So, the relation, it goes posteromedially into the retropharyngeal space. Posterolaterally, it can go into the carotid sheath and then from there it will go to the mediastinum. Okay, so inferiorly it can go to the submandibular space. Okay, so inferiorly to the submandibular space. Anteriorly, if it is going, it will go to the masticator space. Okay, so anteriorly to the masticator space. So actually this parapharyngeal space is a central channel for all this. Retropharyngeal space, posteromedially, posterolaterally spread to the carotid sheath and then to the mediastinum. Inferiorly to the submandibular space and anteriorly it can go to the masticator space. Okay, so that is the important clinical importance of this space also. And if at all this deep lobe of parotid tumors occurs, it will project into the pre-styloid compartment of this parapharyngeal space and this will push the tonsils medially. Okay, see it, if it is grows like this, it will push the tonsil medially towards the oropharynx, push the tonsil medially. So in that cases, I already told you this deep lobe of parotid usually comes through the stylomandibular tunnel into the pushes through the stylomandibular tunnel into the pre-styloid compartment. So in case of approach to that space, we have to cut the stylomandibular ligament. Need of cutting the stylomandibular ligament comes there. And also if the pterygoid muscle is involved, it will present as severe trismus, drooling of saliva, etc, etc. Okay. Knowledge of these relations of this parapharyngeal space is important for localizing the tumor, where the tumor is, by radiological methods. In normal cases, this in both CT and in MRI, this parapharyngeal space will appear as a triangular plane or a triangular shape in axial cut with signals or intensity consistent with fat. Okay, in both CT and MRI, it will present as a triangular area with the fat intensity or fat signals. And if the this displacement of the fat in this area will show some evidence towards the presence of tumor in a particular space. For example, I already told you that the lateral relation is the masticator space and also parotid space. So if the fat in the parapharyngeal space is displaced posteromedially, we can know that if the tumor is in the masticator space. And if it is displaced andromedially, it gives a clue that the tumor is in the parotid space. Like that, with the relations, we'll get some knowledge about the presence of tumor in the related cavities. Okay, so that is the importance. So we discussed about the synonyms of the parapharyngeal space, then the boundaries of parapharyngeal space, the contents, and then what is Rayland's bouquet, what are the components of that, and also relations of this parapharyngeal space.